have the great honor of introducing Joseph Sachs, professor of environmental regulation at Bolt, UC Berkeley. He started his career and began his teaching career at Colorado. He then went to the University of Michigan, where I had the great honor of being his student. He's a fellow at the Center for Advanced Study in the Behavioral Sciences and at the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He asked for a short introduction. This is a short introduction. He won the Audubon Society's Conservationist of the Year Award, the William O. Douglas Legal Achievement Award from the Sierra Club, the Environmental Quality Award of the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. He served under President Clinton as the counselor to the Secretary of the Interior. In his path-breaking Defending the Environment, he said, and I think this is very relevant to us where we are with climate change now, quote, "No magic wand can be waved over the multitudinous problems of environmental quality. No elegant declaration of rights will simply add and quickly solve our problems. Protracted struggle lies ahead, and the citizen fighting to vindicate his or her rights will be a central figure in the struggle. Effectuation of the public interest must begin to embrace the active participation of the public." Professor Sachs.
Thanks very much, Joe. well, this marks a change in the proceedings of the day. We have until this hour heard a series of presentations by distinguished scientists, researchers who do the underlying work of generating knowledge and information about the problems of the environment, the problems of natural order. Now we turn to people like me and Joe and Helen Ingram and others. Our job is to take the knowledge that the people in the scientific and technological community produce to try to understand the implications for the society of those of that knowledge and to try to find ways to implement it in ways that are economic, that are practical, that are acceptable, that are workable, and that ultimately, taken together, meet the needs that that we as members of the society have. What I would like to do today is to take one small piece of the problem, and that is the problem of shoreline property and rising sea levels. Here's what we non-scientists understand about the nature of the problem. The sea levels have been rising for the last 80 years or so in a notable way. I think the sea has risen about 6 inches in the San Francisco Bay area over that period of time. We understand that the projections, the understanding of the most knowledgeable people is that we're likely to see sea level rise over the next 5 decades of perhaps 1 foot in elevation over the next, toward the end of this century, as much as 2 or perhaps even more. I saw recently that the scientific panel recommended to the Bay Delta study that I think expectation of sea level of as much as 39 inches over the century. But whatever, there seems to be no difference of opinion but that we are going to experience some significant sea level. And as you heard Dr. Broker say this morning, that some of the most valuable and most important land, and of course worldwide, very large populations of people live along the sea coasts. And I want to focus not on the kinds of problems, the problems of vast population relocations that we are likely to see arising in places like Bangladesh and other low-lying, densely populated areas, but the, what in a way is the much more simple but much more immediate problem that we see here along the California coastline. Just to talk in very rough way, if you're talking about an ordinary, relatively level coastline, a foot rise in elevation would mean inundation of 100 to 200 feet inland. So if you look around when you go outside and you see where the water's edge is and you think about up and down the coast, a couple of hundred feet inland, we're talking about a pretty significant problem. The problem of dealing with the coastal intersection of land and water from the managerial and from the legal perspective, and I'm not going to go into a complicated or arcane legal discussion, but from that perspective, and just briefly to give you an idea of the uniqueness and difficulty of the problem, I want to show you an illustration. And you'll notice I have very primitive illustrations. You probably haven't seen these kind of things for years. This is showing the land-water intersection, okay? Between here, the mean high water mark, and there, the mean low water mark, is what you ordinarily think of as the wet beach. Here, you see wet beach mark, underwater, the dry beach, and vegetation line. Now, here's the important point, okay? Everything from here, the mean high water line, seaward, belongs to the state, okay? It's public property. And everything above, this is under the ordinary circumstances, everything above the mean high water mark, the dry sand beach, and everything landward of that, is usually private property, unless it's a park or something. So we have what you have everywhere else. You have a boundary line. But unlike just about every place else, this is not a stable boundary line. For example, if we have what's called accretion, that is, you have a gradual building up of sand along the beach, and the water line, the high water line, moves from here down a ways, the property line moves with it. Now the public-private line is here. And if you have what's more common around here is erosion, and you lose some of this sand, and the water line moves up to here, the property line moves with it. So we have a migrating property line. Now, just imagine if your backyard was like that, and sort of moving back and forth in some way that you didn't know how it was going to, where it was going to be. The significance of this is this area, the wet beach, is public property, and it's a public right-of-way. So you can walk on a wet beach. If you'd put on the next slide. For the most part, it's made to be read down like that and then like this. This is a period, these are, I guess, 40-year periods up to 120 years. So you start, and this is showing the rising sea level. So you start with the water line being here. You have some vegetation, and this is showing some vegetation or wetland within the public area, and then some vegetation, some wetland area above the public area, and above that a house, okay? And now it's moving landward, okay? Till finally it moves, here's this power line, You got the water line all the way up to here. So what we have to look forward to as a result of the rising sea level is, if you did nothing, you just allowed nature to take its course, or humanly created natural change to take its course, the sea would migrate landward, and over the century, a couple of hundred feet inland, okay? And these houses, most of which are not built on stilts, as this one was, they'd be underwater. So what's going to happen to all this land, this extremely valuable land, much of which has houses on it, that is going to be inundated, or we expect is going to be inundated, or much of which we expect is going to be inundated, maybe even more than we now expect, over this period of decades. Well, you already know the answer to that in part, if you've ever been on the coast, and that is property owners today who have been affected by significant erosion that we've seen along periods of California coast, in one form or another do what's generically called armoring the coast. And that means building some kind of barrier to hold the water back. And you can go up and down the coast and see this in various ways, along the bluffs where you get erosion eating away the bottoms of these cliffs. People come in and put in cement to hold up the cliffs from collapsing, or you'll see sometimes a rock revetment. People just put rock, kind of a rocks in. Sometimes you see people building a wall. If you put in the third and last of these, here's another example showing some of the same things, where you have a house. You've got the upland, you've got the water here, and you've got somebody standing on the wet beach, a member of the public, he's fishing, and the sign says, "Keep out." You've probably seen those too. They're on the dry beach, on the sand beach, and gradually what's happening is the water is moving back, and at some point this homeowner builds a seawall. And interesting, you notice, our fisherman is up on top of the seawall here. And I'm going to talk about that in just a second. The point of this is that there are two alternatives that you can picture. Alternative number one is that you don't do anything. And as in the previous illustration, the ocean migrates landward, taking everything that's there with it. Alternative number two is the landowner builds a seawall of some kind, armors the coast in some way to prevent the destruction of his house or whatever may be there. And the result of that is that two things happen. One is this public walkway, the wet beach, it disappears. By the time you get here, there is no public beach. And to the extent that there was wetland area there, vegetation within the high water mark, that's gone. So now we've lost the public land, and we've lost wetland, in all of which belongs to the public. It's gone. And the third thing is that the owner has also lost the private beach. There is no private beach anymore. I think most people today, if you just ask them, what do you think about rising sea level? What do you think problems are? They would say, well, I know there are people who have houses on the coast, and I guess they're going to have to build a seawall or something, some kind of a bulkhead or revetment or something to keep the sea out, protect their property rights, and that's certainly part of it. Very few people, I think, would say, you know, the other thing that's going to happen is this public property is going to disappear. So we're going to lose a lot of wetland. And if you could draw a map of some anticipated, reasonably anticipated sea level rise, you would see vast loss of existing public wetlands as well as wetlands that are now on private land, just above, loss of beach, private beach, as well. So we have a very interesting and unusual kind of problem. Because of this public-private intersection, because of these traditional rules about the migrating sea, we have a kind of tension, potentially, between the private interests on the coast, which are extremely valuable and extremely important, and in many places well established, and at least two very important public interests, that is, the public right of the use of the wet beach and wetlands. So the question is, what do we do? What should we do? When should we do it? And how should we do it? And that's what I want to talk about. Let me say just a word about the legal situation, again, without getting into detail. There's a statute in California that says that to protect your property, you can build a seawall to protect existing structures. And that law was passed in the 1970s. There has never been a interpretation of what the word existing in the statute means. That is, whether it means existing as of the time the statute was passed, or whether it means existing as of the time that you want to build the seawall. And that's a question that's much in legal dispute, and a very important, I mean, from that perspective, very important and unresolved question. There's another very interesting question, it's never been decided either, and that is, you've got a migrating sea, migrating toward your house, and you want to protect your house, and you have property rights in your house, and the question is, does the property right in your house include the property right to stop a natural process? I mean, the rising sea is just happening. Maybe it is the result of human activity, or largely the result of human activity, or overwhelmingly the result of human activity, but it isn't like I'm coming, you know, and flooding your land. It is, in that sense, it's a natural process. So do you have a right to stop a natural process? And you might think, yeah, you ought to have that right to protect your house. But I've just told you something else that's interesting, which is, if you have a right to do that, that means you have a right to destroy public land, because that wet beach belongs to the public. It doesn't belong to you. And those wetlands that are below the mean high water mark, which is the technical property line. They don't belong to you either. If you build a seawall, eventually what's going to happen is, I mean, it's going to wash away all that beach and all that public property. And in fact, because it will intensify the wave action up against the seawall, it will actually even speed up the process of losing the beach. So we have a very interesting question. And it's a legal problem that perhaps someday will be resolved by the court. But underlying it is this very important issue of how you somehow accommodate these important public rights, which are not just things that, you know, ought to be public, but actually it's actually public property in the same sense that the fire station is a public property. How you accommodate these public rights and these private rights, and what we ought to do about that. There is actually one place in the country where this issue is actually going through the courts, which is in Texas. Texas has had a lot of erosion, and the Gulf is moving toward a lot of people's property on the Texas coastline. Texas has something we don't have, which is called an open beaches law, which is sometimes called a duty of retreat law, which is that as the water comes in to your property, you have to move backwards. And that law is actually being enforced in Texas and being challenged in the courts. And it might surprise you to think that such an anti-private property kind of law would end up turning up in a place like Texas. But because of the public importance that's traditionally been recreational importance primarily that's been attached to the Gulf Coast in Texas. Texas has this open beaches law and has a very, very extensive law about the public right to use even the dry sand beach, which we also don't have. Okay, so let me turn from those preliminary kind of observations about the nature of the problem that we have to say something about what I think we ought to be doing. And to precede that by saying, for reasons I'll explain, we ought to be doing it soon. And the sooner we do it, the easier it's going to be to do it. And the longer we wait, the more difficult and more problematic it's going to be to do whatever it is that we do. My suggestion would be to divide the problem into three parts. And then I want to say something about each of those three parts. It seems to me the first part is those lands where we already have development, such as residential communities and houses and so forth. And I think as a practical matter, whatever you think about the legal rights and wrongs, we have to protect those properties. We're not going to let the ocean just wash over those properties. So we're going to have to, whatever existing means in the statute, I think we're going to have to let people build or rebuild in many cases where, because there are a lot of places where we have these rock revetments that are just not going to work. We're going to have to build a much more elaborate and expensive kind of seawall. We're going to have to let people build seawalls to protect their property. And with the result that we need to think about what to do about the public right-of-way and what we need to do about the wetlands. And my suggestion is twofold. The first part of it I pick up from someone who's written a great deal about this issue and very intelligently, who works for the U.S. EPA, named Jim Titus, and actually whose illustration this is. And his suggestion is that we ought to make a condition of building seawalls that the landowner build in a public right-of-way along the top of the seawall so that people like this, who used to be here on the public right-of-way, will end up being here to the extent that it's practical to do this. Now, obviously, there are some places where it isn't practical to do this, where you're up at the top of a very high cliff or something. But in a lot of places, it is very practical to do this. And if you do it, if you do it when you build the seawall in the first instance, it's a lot better and cheaper than to do it at the end. That as soon as this person builds the seawall, or as will be the case in many places in California, rebuilds or reconstructs or reinforces the seawall, we require them to make available a public right-of-way, but that they don't actually need to let the public come until the public right-of-way on the beach is lost, so that you have a time period where you can still keep people out if you want to do that. And he suggests, and I think it's a very good suggestion, that this is a relatively easy, inexpensive, straightforward way to protect the private properties along the established private properties along the beach, and at the same time not lose the public right-of-way. As to what to do about the wetlands, the suggestion is that we're going to have to acquire some additional land to allow wetlands to migrate inland in some places, and that some part of the cost of that acquisition ought to be imposed on these folks to make up for the wetlands that are lost as part of the price of protecting their private property. They're allowed to lose whatever wetlands we had in here, that there would be some sort of a financial arrangement, a kind of mitigation charge that would help preserve the wetlands that we need to preserve. So that's the first category. That's how it would be handled in these established areas. The second category is those places where we want to preserve wetlands. And the unstated suggestion here is it isn't going to be practical to have a zero loss of wetlands policy. That is, you're not going to be able to allow all those areas where the sea is rising, where there are existing wetlands, to migrate inland. So we're going to have to decide how much wetlands potentially lost in the rising sea level we want to save, and where those places are, and that we better move relatively promptly, the sooner the better, to acquire an interest in those lands. But the sooner you buy these things, and the less fully you have to own it, the more you can allow the private owners to use it. It's cheaper, and it also is displaces people less. And you ought to do this only in those places where you need to, you've decided that you want to preserve wetlands. And if you don't do something like that reasonably soon, it's going to be gone. So if you want to have a coastal wetlands policy, you need to get moving on it. And there are these are some of the ways of doing it. This is not necessarily the only way of doing it, but these, I think, are some suggestions about how you might go about doing it, or some variation of how you might go about doing it. Then you come to the third category of land, the last category. And those are the lands that are not now developed or are not developed with uses that are so valuable or so important, like beachfront houses that need to be saved. They're not lands that are valuable for your wetland maintenance or substitution policy. By the way, you would use some of the money you got from these people who built the seawalls to buy these easements or lease back. For this third category of land, the notion would be that It's your land. I mean, here's the way you would start thinking about it. You might think, well, it's your land. We don't have any particular public values that we need to protect in the land. And you can do whatever you want with it. It's up to you. Here's the problem with that. Here's why I think we need to have something a little bit more elaborate and more subtle than just saying, it's fine, it's your land, you can do whatever you want with it. What's likely to happen if we just don't do anything is that people will use the land. They will develop the land in some way that's produces a value to them. And then the sea may begin to rise, and we will find potentially a lot of people with a lot of land that they've developed and that's now threatened, and they're not really in a position to protect themselves. They can't afford to build the seawalls. They can't afford to abandon their houses. And what do you think is going to happen? Well, I know, and you know too, because we've seen it happen over and over and over again in floodplains. Just as we know that there are these lands that are threatened by a potential rising sea, we know that there are lands that are in floodplains, that are hazard areas, that are certain to be flooded periodically. Along the Mississippi is one of the famous settings. One might even talk about New Orleans as another famous such case. We know from long experience that despite the fact that these are hazard lands, despite the fact that it may be imprudent for people to make certain kinds of developments on those lands, that in fact they can be developed, they can be sold, people do buy them, and then when disaster strikes, they come and ask to be bailed out by the taxpayers. And because or when the magnitude of the problems is sufficient, and I don't suppose anybody needs to persuade you about this, having just watched the mortgage crisis and the Katrina problem develop, when a problem becomes big enough and enough people are adversely affected by it, the taxpayers pick up the bill in one form or another because it becomes a social problem. It isn't just a private property problem for a private individual. So my thought is, if we are going to learn anything from history, we should learn that these hazard-prone lands are just like floodplain lands, and you can just bet that they are going to, if we do nothing, that they're going to experience the same development that we see in the floodplains, and that when the time comes, because this is just like flood and it's just like hurricane, I mean, it's the same kind of phenomenon, maybe not scientifically or technically, but in terms of the social impact, that you're going to see the same sort of problem. Now, there are a couple of ways of dealing with that. One is to prohibit development or to have very rigorous kind of setback laws. And we certainly need to have some setback laws, I mean, for areas that are very, very immediately or very closely threatened. We can have laws that say to people, we could have retreat laws like Texas and say, you can do whatever you want, and when the time comes, good luck, you know, buy a rowboat. And you can row away from your house. Or you can build your house up on stilts, or you can move your house, or it's up to you. You know, it's your property, and you can do whatever you want with it. That's another alternative. So we could take an extreme and say, we're going to be very paternalistic, and we're going to say, you can't develop on this at all because we think this is hazard land. Or we could say, you can do whatever you want because it's your property. We don't, you know, if you have a problem, it's your problem. Or we could take what I would suggest as a third approach, which is to say we should learn from the history of this. It isn't really the taxpayer's responsibility. And if we can avoid the kinds of things that we have seen happen, we ought to do that. And what I would suggest is what I would call a show me the money approach. To say to people, it's your land, you can develop on it, but because this is hazard land, you need to demonstrate that you will not become a welfare case and become a charge on the taxpayer. And there are a variety of different ways that we could do this. We could impose a charge on people, an annual charge on people that people would pay at the time that they paid their property taxes. That would support a fund to take care of displacement if and when that happened. That would be one way of doing it. We could use the auto insurance approach. We could require people to buy insurance, a hazard insurance, assuming that that was available. My guess is that's not going to be easy to find that kind of thing. The insurance industry is not very creative, and they don't like to insure these kind of hazards, as we see from the earthquake insurance industry. But that's another alternative, and if it's available, so much the better. Or a third alternative would be for something like this, where you've got a relatively long period of time, you're talking about land it's a very interesting problem. 30, 40, 50 years away, you've got a lot of time, which is a good thing. So you don't want to have these rigorous controls on people so that they can't use their land, you just sort of waste it for decades. And in fact, it may not be flooded. I mean, we may have overestimated some of the sea rise. So you could actually, instead of having hazard insurance of the usual kind, you could actually annuitize these houses. That is, you could treat this the way you treat a life insurance policy and say, people pay in, we've got time, see, we've got decades. People pay in a little bit of money every year. That money would be invested like in an annuity. And at the end of 40 years, 30, 40, 50 years, if their house was inundated, they would be paid off out of this fund, whatever the accumulated income and earnings of the fund were. And if they outlived that is just as you can outlive your life insurance, you know, at the end of the policy period, 40 years, they'd just be paid off as if it was any other kind of annuity. So that's another way of doing it. Yet another way of doing it is to require people to assure that they will have the money to build an adequate seawall to protect their property. And we could do that the way we do bonding. You know, you have to put up a bond that would assure that you have the financial wherewithal to build a seawall, because building seawalls along the ocean shore tends to be very expensive, less expensive along these bay shores. So there are a range of alternatives, and I'm not sure that any of them are perfect alternatives, and one may think of other variants on this. But the point I would emphasize to you, and the thing that I think is most important, is one, we need to make this threefold division of established property, property that's important for protecting the I didn't mention habitat, but some of this shoreland is habitat, as well as ocean, as well as wetland, and our public rights. And we need to not get ourselves into a Katrina-type problem in terms of all the other land that isn't land that we need to protect, either for environmental and public purposes or for protecting the existing investment values that people have. That division ought to be made. We need to have a policy to make sure that we don't lose all the public coastal access that we have, to make sure that we don't lose the wetland and habitat values that we have, to make sure that we don't throw an unjust burden on the taxpayers, and finally, that we take advantage of the time. We have one great thing in our favor, and that is we have time, because we're talking about a long-term problem. So that unlike other kinds of disasters, coastal disasters like the cyclone that we've just seen, the tsunami, the hurricane, so forth, where we don't know when they're going to happen, we have a good idea about, you know, not a certain idea, but we have a pretty good idea about the time scale. And as we move further inland, we have more time. So we have time to have, to put into place at a reasonable price and in a way that's consistent with both the private interests of coastal landowners and the public interests of the taxpayers, a sensible and workable kind of policy. This is just a sort of micro version of all these enormous problems that you've heard about earlier in the day. I think it's an example. I'd like to sort of, the message I would like to give is, one, every little piece of these global problems is difficult and needs to be attended to in a very intense way. I mean, they're not problems that you can solve just by having some large public understanding that there's a big problem there. They've got to be worked at. To say that I think that, you know, there are means to deal with these problems if we attend to them relatively soon and don't wait too long. Because once you wait, with a lot of this, it's going to be too late to do anything useful about it. You'll be faced with the Katrina-type fait accompli. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much, Joe. I think we have time. I know we have time for a few questions.
I think it's interesting to look at this in terms of making laws and property rights, but especially since I'm used to looking at it more in an environmental point of view, but already 90% to 95% of our coastal wetlands are gone. You know, saving Bolsa Chica took 15 years, and that was for a piece of land that had already been wrecked. Are we really coming to that time where we need that strong FDR kind of person who's willing to make the hard decisions that we don't seem to be able to make?
I would be the last person in this room, if not the last person in this county, to underestimate the difficulty of getting any kind of intelligent land management done. I've spent lots of years and experienced lots of failures, and as well as a few successes. But there's no way you're going to get anything to happen unless it gets on the public agenda. And I think the point I would like to emphasize most strongly is what people, I think, generally are not aware of, most people are just not aware of, is that this rising sea level problem is going to wipe out public access along the sea, for which there's very strong public support. And I mean, that may be the most important element of this. And I think, as you know, I mean, there's also strong support for wetlands, and this is the time to get moving on dealing with that. Because I think most people see this, it's simply a problem of people's houses being at risk. I mean, that's the way it's usually portrayed and presented, but that's not the only thing that's at risk. Okay, thank you. Beautiful.